and Robert Brown.
Very, very. I think I'm leaving the
first over here.
Listen, you guys, Sherry is in tech for the front page. And she's opening, and up until 15 minutes ago, we were not thinking she was going to be able to come. And she says, I can't make it, we're on time. And Jack O'Brien saw you, like,
that's true.
Forlorn
in
the hallway.
He saw me sitting in the hallway eating sushi. He's like, why are you still here? And I said, because they cut my costume. And he's like, keep your costume on and put your jeans on and go over.
So yeah, 15 minutes. I go back down to Florida every week to start filming the
so, you're really, really great at playing like a backwater kind of bubble gumpy kind of, you know, southern way, southern Florida.
Yeah.
Smoggy.
Okay.
Is it a murdering movie?
He's a misunderstood guy. Let's just leave it at that. Listen, that was an amazing experience we had down there at the Minetta Lane Theater. You know what? I thought it would be fun. Like, share.
No.
No, like, what's like a memory that you have? That, sort of up and coming, and we stopped. No, but I remember just like long nights of like just talking about the characters. Like, you know, it was that time in our lives where like just like utter commitment to what we were going to do. Rehearsing long after the show, like we couldn't stop talking about the backstory, just obsessed with these roles and like this responsibility.
I remember, getting arrested. I had to go out with your understudy because you got arrested for peeing outside.
There was traffic in the Holland Tunnel. I missed one show. I pulled over to take a leak, and yes, I got arrested. And I remember the Minetta Lane Tavern.
Yeah. Yeah, and I remember you teaching me what scotch was.
Yeah.
After the show, not before.
Mm-hmm. You taught me what Lockie Gimlet was.
Not.
You did too. We would go on 2 show days, and we would go down to the Minetta Lane Theater. This is what 15 years ago, when we could still, I could
afford the Minetta
Lane. Yeah. We would go ahead. You'd have a Lockie Gimlet. I'd have 2, 3 or something, and then we'd have like a cigarette, and we'd go like sing the score.
I mean, I see you with a cigarette.
Do you remember how small those dressing rooms were too? Like there's no space.
That's
literally a curtain between these 2 little rooms. It was like I would lay back, and like my feet would like.
Your toes would come into my dressing room.
Oh, that was your dressing room.
Yeah.
The last 5 years, opened off Broadway in 2012, and it really was an amazing time. We played down at the Minetta Lane and made a record in a day.
Yeah, 7 hours.
Yeah.
Started a cast album division of a record label that I used to own, so we could make this record.
Yep, and I think we got 1 take on each song, a couple of pickups, and it's moving on. And that production was directed by Daisy Prince, who I think is great. Woo! The music director was Tom Murray, who was at and 3 members of that original band are playing the show. stone. Explain.
Oh yeah.
The little.
You give the structure part to me. Great. If you don't know, you know, he says weird. I say innovative. But it's the Kathy goes backwards in time, and what's your character's name? Jamie.
There was a revival in 2013. The show is now has literally been performed everywhere from Florida to Finland. It is performed all over the world. Kids in dorm rooms and high school veterans listen and weep to that score.
All folks now.
All folks, yes. You described the show once as, I remember you said this about it, that it was, because nobody really came down to see us, you know what I mean?
September 11th, yeah.
Right, the city was still burning, you know,
yeah.
And you said the show's gonna be like a bottle of fine wine, it was gonna just get better and better and better, and you were right about
it.
That
was my line.
Yeah, you said that. You can say you actually were really sincere and it's beautiful things sometimes.
In private. You can say it in front of everybody.
And there was the movie too, because Richard.
And they were able to envision all these things, and Richard really, like a lot of people love this show, and like we did, and I know we really, really loved this show, and I'm glad that we were able to be a part of it, and I'm glad that they made a film of it, and you should see that.
There's an even bigger reason that we're here tonight, though, and it has to do with...
Yeah.
We'd like to introduce the president of the Brady campaign to eliminate gun violence. Please welcome Dan Gross.
With the two of you, and to be part of such a special evening. Congratulations, everybody, because I think you've snagged one of the hottest tickets in town. It actually sold out in under an hour, so that is not an exaggeration. And I know that it didn't sell out in under an hour for you to listen to me, so I will be brief. First and foremost, I want to give huge, huge thanks to Jason Robert Brown. Super, super grateful. And of course, thank you to tonight's incredible shining stars, Cynthia, Erivo, and Dr. It's just humbling to be able to be a part of this evening, and to think that it's going to help prevent gun violence just takes it to a whole other level. I also want to recognize a few of Brady's board members that are here this evening. Kevin Quinn, our board chair. And Tim Jones and Nancy Lefkowitz. who have bought tickets to be here tonight, and to, by doing that, support the Brady campaign. Your support really is making a difference, and unfortunately, I know firsthand the toll of gun violence in America. In February of 1997, my younger brother Matt was shot in the head in a shooting that happened on the observation deck of the Empire State Building, a mass shooting by a man who never should have had a gun, killed our dear friend Christopher Burmeister as well. But I don't only want to stand here tonight as a testimony to the tragedy of gun violence in our country. As the president of the Brady Center and Brady campaign, and on behalf of all of us, I want to stand here as a reason for hope and a reason for inspiration. Because you see, folks, for every great movement in our country, there's a moment where you can look back and say, that's when things really started to change. And as tonight is testimony, that moment for the movement to end gun violence in America is right now. Enough of the mass shootings in malls and movie theaters and churches and schools and the nightclub in Orlando. Enough of the daily terror of gun violence in our country. Nine lives in our country every single day, and women and young black men in staggering proportions. Enough of easy access to guns by the people that we all agree shouldn't have them, and enough of a small group of craven politicians putting the interests of the corporate gun lobby ahead of the safety of the American people. In half by 2025. It's an audacious goal, but we can get there. We can get there just by keeping guns out of the hands of the people that we all agree shouldn't have them. And we're gonna get there because of nights like tonight, because of people like all of you that have come together and said enough. Enjoy the show.
fucking head that week.
scene, and my professor in Columbia said he called. Yes, yes, Dr. Adler, right. Yeah, I mean, you know, it's just a trap, as I guess, you know, coming along or whatever. Well, look, I don't know if you made or anything, but Dr. Adler thought it would be a good idea if I should. Okay. Should I drop it off in person? Okay. I'll drop it in the mail then. Great, 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 great. Thank you. Thank you. This is great. Thank you. All right, I'll drop it there. Ah, what's your address?
I think we both can see.
Get one. with Kathy. Whoa! Rob. Okay, yeah. I'll meet you down there in 5 minutes. Did I just hear an alarm start ringing? I was flying past. Oh, I don't know what tomorrow's bringing. I've got a singular impression things are moving too fast. I'm glad you're sure that you're a skater. I'm trying to hide as a rocket blast. I just expected it 10 years later. I got a singular impression things are moving too fast. And you say, oh, no, step on the brakes. Whatever it takes to stop me straight.
Oh,
Taylor Coolidge. Get up and dawn and start again with his hundred with a twist. 41 years had come and gone at his tailor shop in Clevelandish. Watching the winter soldier on, there is one thing she will miss. If I only had time, old Shmuel said, I would build a dress that's in my head.
That dress he made. Time, na 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 na, can we be happy? The kids ahead. That one's Jerry Seinfeld. That one's John Lennon. Yeah. No, the Dakota. The San Remo is up a few blocks. Have you been inside the museum? We should go. We the dinosaurs.
Thank you.
world suddenly finds you attractive?
Well, that's not true.
Only is the kind of woman you always wanted to sleep with, but they never gave you the time of day before. And now they're banging down their door and falling to their knees. At least that's what it feels like. You cannot punch them. Close your eyes. Except you're sitting there eating your corned beef sandwich. And all of a sudden, this pair of breasts walks by and smiles into you, and you're like, that's not fair. A miracle would happen, and every other girl would fly away. Thank you.
Thank you.
He touched the wall and decided he had had enough. He was exhausted, first of all, and he could feel it. His lungs were throbbing and heavy, and his left arm was stinging from the shoulder right down to his wrist. Besides that, 7 laps in, and the water was still freezing cold, and if he wanted to be honest about it, he felt foolish. A goose pimple, graceless thing, flapping about frantically, desperately trying to keep pace with the mermaid in the next lane. She was at least half a lap ahead of him, though he hadn't been able to keep track of her at all while he was swimming. Every time he tried to find her while he was catching her breath, she'd be completely out of range. But he could see her now, now that he was grabbing on the side of the pool. He watched her back stretching, watched how she seemed to ride the water. Her arm came up over the ear and slid back over the surface soundlessly, effortlessly. Now she touched the opposite wall and was heading back towards him, and he watched as she changed her stroke, her head coming up and then submerging again in a burst of energy. He could see the shape of her face under her goggles, sense the curve of her breast as she pushed up into the air. She didn't seem particularly familiar at that moment. He didn't recognize the fierceness in her brow, the tension in her biceps, the fury in the pumping of her calves. It had never occurred to him that 3 years in, he would be learning new things about her. It hit him at that moment that there were so many things he could discover as the years passed. A grain in the temples, a slackening at the elbow, a swelling in the abdomen. She touched the wall next to him and pushed off, but she must have sensed something, and she looked behind her and saw him standing at the wall, one arm hanging off the side, his teeth chattering slightly. She slowed down and turned to face him, a quizzical smile crossing her lips. He smiled back at her as she pulled the goggles over her cap. Ah, he thought. There she is. I recognize her now. He would spend the rest of the day trying to determine what was driving her silence, her clenched jaw, her sharp turns away from him. You don't have to let me win, she was screaming. But he couldn't hear it all.
About you, I know things
happy Kathy. At some point down the line, don't begin to relax without some new service to push me yet further from you. Committed some felony, doing what I always swore I would do. I don't want you to hurt. I don't want you to sink. But you know what I think? I think you'll be fine. Just hang on and you'll see. But don't make me wait till you do to be happy.
Focus on his career. He pulled me off with a heart from there.
Thank you. I hold a leash to help me pack my bags. I went downtown and closed the bank account. It's not about another shrink. It's not about another compromise.